But Bahrain, not different from the rest of the region, we still heavily dependent on hydrocarbons. Let's call it oil. The downward pressure on oil prices naturally has significantly reduced revenues. On the other side of the coin, you have continuous need for subsidies, continuous need for social spending, be it public housing, be it subsidies I referred to. So the pressure is on. I think this entire region will have a very challenging rest of 2015, and in my humble opinion, a very challenging 2016. How does that reflect on the banks? Much of the spending and the project here are dependent on government spending. So when governments, be it Bahrain, be it all the neighboring countries, either hold back on projects or shelve them or delay them, then you're talking about the trickle-down effects into the system, which eventually has to reach the banks, either from a providing facilities standpoint, from taking deposits, from financing companies that provide tires for contractors and so on, or fuel or catering and so on. So will this affect banks? I think indirectly it has to. It has to. Case in point, many of us bankers in Bahrain complained of how liquid we are. And while that sounds like not much of a problem, but when you have excess funds as a bank, you have to deploy those funds. Otherwise, you're not getting the returns for your shareholders and owners and so on. So in the absence of a clear strategy of government spending, then I think it will affect adversely in some way affect the banking sector in any country, not just Bahrain. I mean, politics and economics go hand in hand. And most of the times, politics lead economics. A technical opinion by a very well-respected person, people can maybe hear it, but not listen to it as much as they would to a stronger political opinion. This is a fact. Now, the fact that there's conflicts in the region is not a secret. It's there, and coverage is amazing in terms of not just social media, but normal media and so on. Does that affect us here? I think I'd be lying if I said no. It has to affect us for one simple reason. It's called sentiment. It's called confidence in the region. If there is no stability, or if stability is in question, then capital either may not come or capital may fly out. You know, I think if there were no great pressure on revenues, we wouldn't be having this discussion. But in my 3.5 or so years in Bahrain, in every forum, economic forum, the issue was discussed. I've been visited by the World Bank, the IMF, rating agencies like Fitch and Standard & Poor's. Every one of those people raised that question. So does that mean it's an important question? If it wasn't, all these reputable agencies would not be raising it. From my point of view as a banker, I think if you need to have a free economy, I think if you need to teach people how to fish rather than give them a fish, then you cannot avoid the issue of not necessarily lifting subsidies. I think that's a hot, very, very hot political issue. But the way they're done now, there has to be a review or revisiting of the way we do subsidies here. And let me be vocal about it. I, as an expatriate in this country, I'm privileged to be here, but why am I subsidized? Why am I subsidized? You've got about 600 some odd thousand people who are non-Bahrainis. I am publicly saying they shouldn't be subsidized. Now, for the rest of the people of the land, it's their country. If the government wants to subsidize them, then be it. But even with that, I think there should be, we should be a bit more selective as to what subsidies we give. All in all, I think subsidies should be reviewed. Some should be lifted slowly. We may use a different system. Some countries use a voucher system and so on. What commodities whether it's foodstuff, fuel and so on, we subsidize should be also revisited. So to answer the question, should we lift subsidies or not, it's not that simple. I think we should revisit the way we as a country provide these subsidies. To whom, for what, for how long, yeah, and how.